Good evening. Welcome to the College of Complexes. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Tim, and I'd like to welcome everybody to the College of Complexes tonight. The College of Complexes consists of the following format. First, we'll have a brief announcements period. Second, we will have our speakers speak for a little while. Then there'll be a question and answer period. After the question and answer period, we will then proceed to our free speech forum. I know there's been a little bit of concern about the coronavirus recently, and I'd like again just to remind everybody that this is being a forum. Proper hand washing, sanitation, watch yourself. Charlie, could you please knock it off? Charlie? All right, again, a brief word about coronavirus. We all like coronas. We all want to have the line tonight, not the virus. So I'll ask again for everybody to have, just remember your health guidelines the governor's put out, and let's have a good college tonight. I just want to recognize our waitress, Heather. She is having a little bit of issues, but let's give her a round of applause for her. She's been here for quite a while and helped herself. You've been lying with Corona. Let's recognize her again with another rousing round of applause.
Should we tip her?
No, just clap.
Waitress of the year.
All right.
Just clap, everybody. Your applause is good enough for me.
Anybody else?
All right. Tonight, we're having a speaker. Her name is Ada Cheng, and Ph.D. This will be an interpretive presentation, interactive presentation through facilitated dialogue, as she will explore the following issues. One, what is toxic masculinity? Two, why it is important to examine it under the current sociopolitical climate? Three, where does it all start and how does it manifest itself? Four, how does it affect us all? And five, how can individual and collective changes take place? The presentation will be facilitated by Dr. Ada Cheng, a professor turned storyteller, solo performer, and storytelling show producer. She was a tenured professor at the Rye University for 15 years from 2001 to 2016. She is currently the education and outreach specialist with Campus Advocacy Network at Women's Leadership and Resource Center at UIC. You can check out her website at www.renegadeadachain.com. Let's give a rousing round of applause for our main speaker tonight, Dr. Ada Cheng. Sorry. Let's give another round of applause for Dr. Ada Cheng.
Can you make that thing stay down? Look how it's too hot for her.
Okay,
All right. Oh, this is good enough. Can I kind of lower? Yeah. I'm not that tall. All right, this is perfect. All right, thank you so much. How's everyone doing? Good. Good. Thank you so much for having me. And I've been doing this workshop for a couple of years. I used to teach at DePaul, and gender, sex, sexuality, masculinity is a topic that I used to teach. And at some point I realized after I left the academia, I wanted to bring the subjects to the general public because it is important for us to have this conversation. And so I started doing facilitating conversation with different groups throughout the different neighborhoods here in Chicago, but also suburbs. Today what I'm doing is a little bit different, I mean more presentation style. Usually I don't do it this way, I facilitate the conversation, but I'm happy to adapt to this particular format. And so, what does it mean to be a man? What's masculinity? This is really important topic for all of us, and why is that? As I do training in with college students on sexual assault, domestic violence, harassment, and stalking. And I usually find that, you know, when people come to the table, young men or men in general, young boys, when they come to the table, if we start with a conversation about sexual assault, domestic violence, and intimate partner violence, people get very defensive because no one wants to be regarded as seen as a perpetrator, right? But if we start with the culture of toxic masculinity, it's much easier for us to understand how can we get to the point of wrestling with the issue about sexual assault, domestic violence. And this is one reason to start. My sort of purpose of doing these facilitating conversation and presenting this material is going beyond holding men accountable. Really, it's about holding our culture accountable. That is, let's look at what's the source, right, of how we come to this point and how the culture of toxic masculinity affects all of us, right? And reflecting, and so part of it is also for all of us to reflect on our own complicity and resistance to the culture of toxic masculinity, meaning all of us conform to the culture and resist to it to a certain degree. And so what I do this is really for people to reflect on their own, not just their own thinking, but their practices and how we perpetuate that. And everybody is complicit in that process to a certain degree. But also demonstrating there's a stake for everyone, right? Not just for women, non-gender, non-binary people, but everyone. And you will see, and so this is what I'm doing. So if you think about toxic masculinity, if you look at contemporary urgent social issues of our time, toxic masculinity is always under, right, and part of it, the underlying issue. If you think about domestic violence, sexual assault, gun violence, mass shooting, white supremacy, political extremity, all of it, at the core of it, there is the element of toxic masculinity. You can't get away from it. And so for example, if you, I'm not going to talk, go over a lot of the statistics, but I'll give you a number. Nearly half of all female homicide victims are killed by a current and former dating partner, according to a 2017 study by U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And in recent reports, guns and violence against women, that by the gun control group, 80% of children killed in mass shootings were shot in incidents tied to family and intimate partner violence, right? That's between 2009 and 2018. On average, nearly 20 people per minute are physically abused by an intimate partner in the United States. And that's, and during the same year, this equates to more than 10 million women and men. One in four women and one in nine men experience severe intimate partner physical violence, intimate partner contact sexual violence, or stalking with impacts such as injury, fearfulness, post-traumatic stress and disorder. Now, let's look at a result on sexual assault. Girls and young women between the age of 16 and 24 experience the highest rate of intimate partner violence, right? So that's the age group that I work with. Sexual assault in the United States, one in five women and one in 71 men will be sexually assaulted at one point in their lives. In the United States, one in three women and one in six men experience some form of contact with sexual violence in their lifetime. I mean, I can go on and on with the statistics, but I'm not going to do that. You'll get a sense in terms of we're facing issue of violence and we need to figure out what's the reason. Now, here's the thing. Men commit 90% of homicides in the United States and represent 77% of homicide victims. So men are the demographic group most at risk of being victimized by violent crime. And they're 3.5 times more likely than women to die by suicide. And their life expectancy is 4.9 years shorter than women. And toxic masculinity is so serious to the point that American Psychological Association issued a new guideline in 2018 to list toxic masculinity as one of the risk factors, right? And this is a long time, it's accumulating through 40 years of research that really examined how traditional masculinity can be psychologically harmful, right, to men and everyone around them. So now, what is toxic masculinity? So let me sort of, but let's start with masculinity. What are some of it? I'm just going to kind of ask you a question. If you don't mind, just throw out some terms and loud enough. When we talk about characteristics, traits associated with masculinity, masculine, what are some of the traits?
Just bravado.
Bravado. Okay, keep going.
Authoritarian.
Keep going.
Anger.
Muscles. Anger. Keep going.
Muscle.
Keep going.
Closed-minded.
Okay. Keep going.
Arrogant.
Okay. Keep going.
Superior.
Okay. Keep going. Strength.
Football.
Football. Okay. Very good. We'll come to that. Strength.
Sport.
Absolutely. Dominance.
Self-righteous.
Fear.
Okay. Fear. Aggressiveness.
Narcissistic.
Power.
Power. Yeah.
Now, let's think about what are the traditional traits that are associated with masculinity. Dominance, power, aggressiveness, detachment of emotion, rationality, independence. Now, let me ask you, are these traits inherently bad? So, aggressiveness necessarily bad?
No.
Are there situations where aggressiveness is important?
Yes.
In what sense?
Sometimes.
Give me one.
Sometimes.
Under what context? Give me a context.
Playing chess.
Absolutely. Sports. Right?
Against
sports.
Events.
Now, it's
defending
dominance.
Defending your home. Defending your family.
Okay.
Defending your country.
Absolutely. Is dominance inherently bad?
No.
Not necessarily. Under what context can dominance be important?
A woman trying to tell a man something who refuses to listen.
Running to college.
So for example, making decision as a leadership, right?
Yeah.
Especially decision in crisis situation. Now, here's the thing. Traditionally, when we think about, and this is debatable, but when we think about toxic masculinity, we're talking about when we take these traditional traits to the extreme, to the point that that's the only mode of operation that becomes a problem. So for example, aggressiveness can be necessary in situations like sports, right? Competition.
Right.
But when you take that to the extreme, to the point where that is the only way of operation, where that's the only way that you can coexist with others, then that becomes a problem. Dominance may not necessarily be bad in situation in crisis. But when you take that to the extreme, to the point where that's the only way that you can operate, that the only way that you can live with other people is to have power over them, then that becomes a problem. Detachment of emotion, independence, is not necessarily bad. But when you take those traits to the extreme, to the point where you don't feel that you need to be emotionally attached to anyone, or you don't need to be interdependent to anyone, then that becomes the problem. So when we talk about toxic masculinity, we're talking about traits that when you take the extreme, and that can be harmful to boys, young men, and everyone around them, right? So now, then the question is, how did it all start? So think about this. As human beings, when we were born, we possess a wide range of characteristics, potentials, and capacities. We are both strong and weak. We can be independent, but at the same time, also interdependent. We're all rational, but also emotional, right? That we are strong, but we can also be vulnerable at the same time, right? But what happens is that right from the start, that at the moment of birth, that our society decided, by looking at what's between our legs, and then we decided, we're going to channel one group and develop one group with only certain traits. And then the other group, we're going to raise them with other traits. Then that becomes a problem, right? So think about this. How did it all start? So this is the traits of masculinity and femininity. The best way to think about what it means to be a man in this culture, in this country, is by what? It's by thinking about, it's all embedded in our language, by asking the worst insult.
Actually, it's that from the family. Yeah?
Yeah?
The family. Inside
of the family. It's through the worst insult that you can say to boys, young men, and men. Now, what's sort of worst insult that people can say to men?
Don't be like a girl.
Huh?
Girly
man. Keep going.
Don't be like a girl.
Don't be like a girl. Very good. Keep going.
Don't be weak.
Huh? Weak. Keep going.
Now you're really.
Don't cry.
Don't cry like a girl. Don't cry.
They feel insecure.
Yeah? Bitch. Right?
Insecure.
Sissy? Wuss?
Sissy, yeah.
Right? Pussy? Mm-hmm. Right? We say all these things. And then the other word, faggot. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, these are the things that kids here, day in, day out, and it's so embedded in our language. But what are these insults teaching us? You learn three things right from the start. First, you learn to be a man, to be masculine in this country is not to be what?
Not to be like a girl.
To be a girl, to be a woman. Mm-hmm. So right from the start, masculinity at the core of it is a rejection of femininity. Is a rejection of womanhood, right? Right from the start. It's all embedded in our language. Number two, what do you also learn right from the start? If you're a young boy, if you're told, dang it down, don't throw like a girl, don't cry like a girl, don't be like a girl,
don't run
you
like
learn that as a boy, you're assumed to be superior to the girls. You learn that you are higher in the social hierarchy. But here's also the thing. Girls also learn at the same time that they are assumed to be inferior, that they are lower in the social hierarchy. Now, what's the third thing that you learn? That you learn is not to be gay. To be masculine, to be man in this country is not to be gay. And homosexuality is traditionally associated with femininity. So right from the start, from the insults, you learn these lessons about difference, about social hierarchy, but also about what? Power, right? Now, how did it all start? So toxic masculinity embedded in the language is about what? Misogyny. It's about homophobia. Now, this is what I want to say. This is not to say that people are good people. But it is also important for us to think about, regardless how good you are as a human being, if day in and day out, you are getting that message in your head that you as a group is better than other people, something is going to come through. And I'll talk more. And I also want to emphasize, we don't always follow the culture to the teeth. We resist, we challenge culture. So I want you to think about, how do you challenge culture? How do you conform to culture? How did it all start? How do you think we start marking gender? And I want you to go back to very early on. What was the earliest moment in our stages of development, our life, that people start marking gender?
It's a boy.
Absolutely, the moment we were born. What do you, when people are, babies are born, what was the first thing that
saved?
Boy or girl. It's a boy or girl. We want to know right from the start. Here's the thing. We don't know what these babies are going to be like. The only thing that we see is that marker of difference, which is that physical difference. But we already use that physical difference to denote social meanings. So we ask, is that a boy or a girl? Now, what else do we do to mark gender?
Pink for girls and
blue. Absolutely. We use color, right? So you see the new babies, new rooms for, right, nursing room for babies. If it's girl, it will be pink. If it's boy, it will be blue. But if I tell you, decades ago, the blue is for girl. The pink is not just for girl, it can also be boy. Colors have no inherent meanings except later on it's given social meaning of gender, right? Now, what else do we do? What else? What other things can we do to mark gender? Toys. Now, what toys did you have when you were young?
Weapons. Guns.
Gun?
Soldiers.
Soldiers. Keep going.
Trucks.
Trucks. Keep going.
Barbie.
Lego? How many of you are Lego?
Legos.
Now, let me ask you.
Baseball.
Cowboys.
Okay.
Model
now,
trains.
Action fingers. Action figures, right? Let me ask you. What do you do with a gun? You shoot, shoot, shoot.
Bad guys, yeah.
You shoot. What do you do with a car?
Run over people.
You drive forward. What do you do with a tank? You crush things. What do you do with Lego?
Build.
You build things. What do you do with soldiers?
Fight.
You fight. What do you do with dogs?
Dress them up.
Dressing up. Take care of Barbies. Let me ask you, how many of the men here have Barbies, have dolls?
No.
How many of the women here have Legos or guns or tents?
No, I had Legos.
You guys all have Barbie dolls?
Right. And what I want you to think about is this. Toys are not just for children to play. Toys are ways that babies, children, toddlers use to dream about their future. Toys have social meanings. So if right from the start, you're given Lego, then you learn buildings. If you're given soldiers, you learn, you fight. If you're given a car, drive, you're always moving forward. If you have a tank, you learn to crush things. Soldiers, fight. But for girls, it's about taking care of somebody, dressing up, cooking. These are social roles that we assign without knowing whether children really want to take care of children. How do you know that all the boys really want to fight? How do we know that they may not want to take care of people, that they may enjoy cooking? How do we know that girls necessarily want to take care of babies, that they may also want to build things and fight and shoot guns? But what we do right from the start is to look at a genitalia and then we decide it. One group, we're going to give them certain things for them to dream very different kind of future. And then the other group, and we're going to say, this is your future. So think about this. Now, another thing to think about. What other things that we can use to mark gender? Clothing? Now, let me ask you, how many of the men here, when you were young, wore dresses? No. How many of the women here, when you were young, you wore dresses? Also wore pants? Okay, so we see that girls are oftentimes allowed to cross, but not necessarily boys allowed to cross the other side. Now, why is this significant? What can you do with the way you wear pants? Can you roll on the ground? Can you?
Yeah.
Can you get dirty?
Yes.
Yeah. Can you climb tree?
Yes.
Can you run around?
Yes.
Now, how many of you have sisters? All right, now you think back. When young girls, when they wear skirts, when they wear dresses, what do parents say to them?
Don't get dirty.
Don't get dirty. What else?
Keep your legs together.
Huh?
Keep your legs together, right?
Keep your legs together. Be like a lady.
Don't roll down a hill.
Yeah? Right. So here's the thing. Clothing have social meanings. One set of clothing allow you to run around, get dirty, climb the trees, right? The other one really doesn't allow you to do anything except tell you to sit up tight, sit straight, be proper.
Now,
if you're willing to indulge me, can I ask you to do me a favor? I want you to kind of think for a moment, right? I'm going to ask you to do something. I want you to now sit like the opposite sex. Go ahead. Please sit like the opposite sex. Please do. Is it comfortable?
No.
Is it comfortable?
No.
Are you sitting like the opposite sex? Is it comfortable? Oh, sorry, you're operating. Right? Is it comfortable? Now, go back to the original stance. Now, go back to the opposite sex. What's the difference for you?
It's not comfortable
when you sit like the opposite sex. Right? Why is that?
I don't have an answer for that.
Habituated.
Well, women don't sit comfortably, that's why.
Now you know how the other half feels. Now, what's the difference when you get to spread your legs? When you sit like the opposite, how did you feel?
Kind of a little exposed, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. How many of you feel like you take up more space?
Yes.
Yeah.
So think about this. The way that we are taught to sit is not just about sitting. It's training us to think about how we should take up space. So for example, when I was a kid, right, wear skirts, dresses, my mother would say, sit tight, like a girl. In my head, I already condition myself, censor myself. When I sit on that chair, I know the amount of space that I should take up, that I have already have this internal conditioning that I'm not going to take up more space, right? On the airplane, I learn right from the start. Nobody needs to tell me, right? I don't do this because I already learn in my own gender socialization that I don't take up more space than I'm supposed to. But here's the thing, that when if your boys raises, you know, assigned as male, raised as boys, you're given permission and liberty to sit with your legs spread. You're encouraged to take up space. Think about, with your clothing, you're allowed to run around, to explore the space, to expand your horizon. What this tells us, it's not just about the clothing, it's not just about how you sit, but it's training your head, your psychology, your psyche, to think how much liberty and freedom and sense of entitlement that you have, or you can have. So boys are oftentimes encouraged, given liberty, to expand space, to explore, right, without much of a limitation. But for girls, oftentimes is sit proper, sit straight. Limit your, don't take too much space. And we see that over and over again, right, in different things. Now, let me give you, we're just going through childhood. We're not even getting into elementary schools, right? So childhood. Do you remember, think back, the first moment that you hurt yourself?
Yeah, I know.
That you started crying? Do you remember that moment?
I remember.
That's okay. Can you think back when you were as young as when you were a kid? The moment when you failed?
Yeah, I remember.
When you hurt yourself, you started crying?
I had sports injury.
Yeah?
So I remember.
Do you remember what your parents said to you?
Don't cry, endure pain.
What? Who said that?
Charlie.
Don't cry, what? Don't cry. Say, go ahead. What did your parents say to you when you started crying?
It was happened in the way from the school. We a bunch of kids from the school.
Yeah.
And it was not parents like near you, and it was very hard. I had sport injury.
Right.
I started gymnastic and I had sport injury. It was very hard.
Yeah.
And I remember it was crying like automatically, you know, like it was automatically crying because you were in pain.
Right. Now let me ask you.
Stop crying, I'll give you something to cry about.
I heard that. Let me ask the man here. How many of you have been told, don't cry, you're a boy. Boys don't cry. Have you heard of that?
Yeah, why not?
Raise your hand.
I don't
remember. Right? How many of you have been discouraged by your parents from crying? Raise your hand. How many of you, let me ask this a really important question. How many of you control your own crying because you didn't want to be seen as weak? The men here, yeah? All right, how about women here? How did your parents respond to you?
Oh, I control crying because I don't want to look funny.
Okay. Do you remember your parents tell you not to cry because you're a girl? Girls don't cry. Do you hear that?
No.
Why is this important? And I want you to think about this. So traditionally, girls are given permission to cry, to express emotions. Right from the start, boys, when they're very young, when they hurt themselves, started crying. Most often time, there are messages from their parents, teachers, and everyone around them who might say, it may not be specifically these words, but don't cry. Boys, don't cry. You don't want to be seen as weak. You want to appear strong. Why is this important? I want you to think about this really important, right? Really carefully. As children, regardless of your gender, don't we all feel fear as children? Aren't there times that we really want to cry when we were kids? Aren't there times that we feel weak? Aren't there times when we were kids that we really want to ask for help? As human beings. So here's the thing. What do you think? And this is what I want you to say to oftentimes when I facilitate this workshop. I oftentimes say, this workshop is not about demonizing men. If you were consistently discouraged from expressing emotions, from revealing vulnerability, from discouraging from asking for help. And you were told that you were not allowed to express emotions because when you express emotions, that will be seen as weak. Where do you think emotions will go?
Like anger?
Suppressed.
Yeah.
You feel anger, like insecure.
Emotions don't go anywhere. They go deep down. And they become what? When emotions go inside, what do they become?
Depression.
Anxiety.
Anger.
Anger. Violence. So this is really a suicidal thought. So here's the thing. What's really interesting we find for young girls, suicidal thoughts are violence toward themselves. For boys, oftentimes their violence, they express it as violence, externalize their violence. If you were never taught how to express emotions, productively and constructively. How do you think eventually emotions are going to come out?
Dysfunction.
Explosive. Explosion. And what's more important, this is what I want you to think about, the way that we're raising human beings. Isn't that also very oppressive to you? Where you are told that it's not appropriate to express your emotions right from the start? That you can't acknowledge your weakness and vulnerability? That you can't ask for help? When we are all human beings and we all have need, when the only way that you can appear human is to be strong, isn't that also very dehumanizing and oppressive, but also traumatizing? And what I oftentimes say to men is this, half of your humanity is deprived. What's a full human being? Is that if you're able to express a whole range of emotions, capacities, and to develop possibilities as human beings. But think about how oppressive that is to you, how dehumanizing and traumatizing that is if you are only allowed to express half. And you have to actively suppress the other half. Unfortunately, the other half eventually will come up, and oftentimes through anger and explosion and violence. Are we surprised that if you think about a school shooting, oftentimes by young white men,
yeah.
Right? There's another race component I'm not going to focus on here, right? But think about it. Is that why it is consistently, and this is not to say that men cannot be victims, men can be, right? But a higher percentage of perpetrators of violence are men. And why is that? Now, let's keep going, right? Sports. What did you play? Sports.
Hockey.
Hockey? Yeah.
Football.
Yeah.
No.
All right. Football. No. Soccer. How many of the one? How many of the men here have done cheerleading before?
No.
No. How many of the women here have cheerleading? Right? So here's the thing to think about it. What do cheerleaders do? They cheer, applaud. Yeah? We see girls and young women move to sports that are traditionally male dominated. But we don't see a lot of permission for young boys and men to move to a more feminine sort of type of sports, like cheerleading. And that fits exactly our gender. Now, I want you to think about toxic masculinity as what? As a mask that you're wearing. And it's not just that you suddenly became a boy and man, you're dumb. It's to what extent you have to constantly prove your membership of masculinity every step of the way. Right? Now,
this is my homework here.
What? Go ahead.
Me?
Go ahead.
Men go into cheerleading in college, but they're always the leader. They're always out in front.
Absolutely.
Of the regular cheerleaders and the
absolutely.
The pep club and
absolutely.
They never belong to the pep club.
Right.
They lead them.
Right. This is something I want you to think very carefully. You know, when we talk about the depriving of the ability and permission to express emotions and vulnerability, right? That is, on the one hand, we give boys and men the status and power and position and prestige and respect, all these. At the same time, right, we deprive them. We don't give the permission for them to express emotions. We only want to see them as strong. And how is that going to play out? That is going to play out when we only oftentimes see women as victims and see men as perpetrators. And when men become victims, we don't want to acknowledge that. Right? So because we can't see, we don't seem to be able to see boys and men as victims. And I'll come to that particular point. Now, why is this important? So I do, as for gender-based violence training with young people on college campus, by the time they get to college, it is already too late, right? Why are we wrestling with this issue? And right from start, I want you to think about boundary violation, right? So right from the start, boys and girls are taught to be very different. One group are told to expand their horizon, explore the space. There's really no boundary. The other group, we say, there's a boundary, right? There's a limit, right? Now, let's think about in middle school and high school. Think back in middle school and high school, and this may not be, you know, with the younger generation is particularly true. What do we call boys and young men with multiple partners?
Studs.
Players? Popular. Players? Stud?
Lucky.
Right? People respect them. Men particularly respect them when they have multiple
Playboys,
partners, right?
Right?
Right? Right? Right? Right? Right? Now, what do we call young women with multiple partners?
Sluts.
Or? Right? Promiscuous. And what do we call when young women don't want to have sex?
Frigid.
Yeah.
Fish.
So, see? Is the same behavior. All of us are human beings with the same desire, with the same need for human compassion, desires, expression of sexuality, right? But we label very different social meanings to the same behavior. One group, we applaud, right? The sexual prowess is the how you mark your masculinity and manhood. The other group is like double bind. If you have multiple partners, we call you slut or tramp. And if you don't want to have sex, then we call you rigid and prude. Damn if you do, and damn if you don't. Now, how is this important? Let's keep going. Now, back in middle school or high school, how many of you have the experience where your female friends have told you that their boundaries are being violated? How many of you remember that? Their bras are grabbed. How many of you remember that?
Their bras are what?
Their bras, or people grab their bra, right? I have talked to young people. Young women would tell me, you know, their boundaries are people touch them, their bra being grabbed, and they feel that they're being violated. And here's what I want you to listen very carefully. It's not just a problem, it's not just the young people. It's also the adults around them. So when they complain to adults, and it may not be true for younger generations anymore, but it's still true. When they complain to adults, parents, teachers, most of the time teachers and parents will say, boys will be boys. Mm-hmm. And they will also say, he likes
you.
Now,
that means he likes
what's the saying? Is that very early on, our society as a whole already dismisses young women's claim, right? Young women's assertion about their boundary. We dismiss, right, their experiences. And then not only that, we say, boys will be boys. We excuse young boys' behavior, young men's behavior, right? We don't necessarily hold them accountable, right? And then we say, he likes you. So here's the thing. And this is not to say everybody will violate boundaries. This is not saying that. But this is to say the larger cultural milieu. If you're persistently given permission, right, whether you do or not, to allow to violate boundaries without any penalties, it is very difficult for you to recognize how to respect other people's boundaries. So why is this important? We raise people with very different sets of boundaries. One group, their claims, their insistence on their boundaries is consistently denied by the adults around them. And we're talking about men, women, everybody. Right? The other group are often given permission or are not necessarily held accountable for their behavior. By the time they get to college, you're going to have young men who really have trouble understanding how to understand and respect boundaries set by other people. Now, let me give you a couple of examples. So I have been, you know, doing training sometimes with young people, and they would ask, what if she's drunk, right? Sexual assault situation, they would say, what if she's drunk? I want to give you, think about this. Rich person on the hill, rich person's house is robbed. And the rich person say, my house is robbed. Our response has always been, I'm sorry, call the police. I'm sorry that your house gets robbed. When women are sexually assaulted, what are the most common things that we go to in our head?
Sorry.
Huh?
Sorry.
What were you wearing?
No, I say, reaction like somebody tell you that, and you say, so sorry.
So sorry, okay. But oftentimes, what do we think about? What questions do we ask?
A question if she called the police.
So sometimes people will ask, how much drinks do you have? Do you know the person?
Right.
Why did you stay up late? Right?
They don't suggest they call the police.
What were you wearing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They'll blame it on you.
We blame victims when it comes to victims of sexual assault. I have to use, we live in a country where we have more respect for property than women's bodies. I have to use property as a way for people to understand a woman's body is her property. And that comes from very early on, the way that we're victim-blaming young girls, right? Young men will also ask this question, what if she's drunk? Imagine, a drunk person here, a computer, $5,000, a bag of fashionable clothing. Would take that computer, that $5,000, that bag of clothing without wrestling with your conscience. You wouldn't take it.
No.
Then imagine the drunk woman. Her body is her property. If we don't flinch, if we don't wrestle with it, we know for sure that we would not take that computer, $5,000, or that bag of clothing. And whether she is drunk or not is irrelevant. Young man will also ask this question. What if I accidentally sexually assault somebody when I use alcohol and drugs? And so this is how I respond. And after that, I'm going to stop.
Okay.
Of course, when we drink alcohol, use drugs that compromise our cognitive ability. But this is something very important to think about. How many of you have ever thought about, I might accidentally kill somebody if I drink alcohol or use drugs?
No.
Does it ever cross your mind?
No.
No. Why is that? Because killing somebody is so morally wrong that it's deep into our conscience that we don't even think. That we know even if our cognitive ability is compromised, even if we drink or use alcohol or use drugs, we will never go there. violating boundaries of another human being is not yet so steep in our consciousness that we people are still asking this question, what if I accidentally sexually assault somebody? Well, here's also the thing. Then I ask, what do you think you need to do if you are worried that you might accidentally sexually assault somebody?
Don't drink.
Don't drink. Right? We have drunk driving. If you know you drink, use alcohol, you're going to hurt somebody on the road.
Don't drink.
Don't drink. And so what I want people to think about is the way we attach morality to different issues. Killing somebody is wrong, but boundary violation, particularly women's bodies, not yet. So I'm going to stop here. I know it's about an hour, and that's good.
Go ahead. Okay, let's thank our speaker. Let's take questions. All right. Do you feel you need somebody to help you call on people, or can you?
Sure, you can call people.
Unless you want to help out Karina with moderating.
You guys got to learn your
boundaries. It's not calling people.
All right, well.
Maybe she can handle it.
I think you can handle it. We'll just.
Wait, you're just going to moderate.
I don't mind. Okay, anyone wants to hear me?
Well,
Andy,
going to
do it?
Yeah, Andy's going to do it. Hit the public.
How does this work? Do I need to get off to the...
No, we'll have questions and answers. All right.
You got the first question.
You know, I've been raised a lot in the Christian church. And, you know, aside from your bit of where, you know, a man is a man and he has these characteristics, mm-hmm. a woman is a woman and she has these characteristics, the way I was brought up was to respect women, mm-hmm. respect the body, respect the mm-hmm. boundaries. Mm-hmm. And I had a, but yet at the same time, what I'm hearing from you is that the identities that we teach our children are wrong. Can you comment and clarify? Because I was raised that, you know, men are leaders, they do things, women all can also be leaders. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's okay for women to work and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But, you know, a woman was still a woman, meaning, you know, she had certain characteristics. Maybe not so much the character and everything mm-hmm. else, because we were able to differentiate between a woman who was very active in sports and had an aggressive personality mm-hmm. versus the one who was docile. And I also knew men, too, who were artistic mm-hmm. as well as aggressive in football, but I do know that there was a lot of role differentiation, but I've often found that, like, for example, comment on what I just said, please, if you could.
So, the way to think about it, you know, as I mentioned, is not, none of us lived according to the culture to the T.
Okay.
So this is a larger cultural ideology, the way we think about how women and men should be. It doesn't necessarily mean that this is how we are individually. And as I sort of repeat over and over again, is that we all resist and conform, right, to the culture. Now, what I want to sort of say is this. Are men and women different or the same? And the question for me is really, of course, there's in terms of biological difference. But to what extent that biological difference justifies the differential gender role? And a differential power difference. Does that make sense? That is,
yes.
That difference in terms of what's between our legs, does that justify the whole cultural framework that men and women are supposed to be this different? Right? That women cannot play soccer or football, or men cannot be cheerleaders. Right? That women, young girls have to be given Barbies. Can boys be given Barbies? That is, that biological difference, to what extent we use that biological difference to justify the gender difference, when in fact, men and women and boys and girls are very similar as human beings, right? And to justify the power inequity that we're talking about. That's what I mean. Now, here's the thing. How do we raise children? I say, raise better humans. Respect children's capacity for all possibilities, right? Not just in terms of fitting to categorize them into a particular gender norms, but to say, what is this little human being like? Can we raise this human being based on who they might be, as opposed to what we think the society expectation for them? And you raise your hand, I would turn.
Okay.
George.
I was going to say, I noticed in the 1960s, a lot of these men would hang out with the women just to get sex, and they wouldn't complain. People like Joe Biden, Ted Kennedy, Harvey Weinstein, those kind of people back then. And even now, Biden is still messing with women, but nothing is said about him.
But not yeah. Trump. Yeah. Yeah.
So what is that? Yep.
The whole Me Too movement, part of why I talk about is how Me Too movement is really, we are looking at hindsight, right? A lot of things that, and this is increasing, it's not that it was ever okay. It just, we, sort of the complaints were never taken seriously, right? Women have been challenged in boundary violations for a long, long time. So now, you know, if you look at now the Me Too movement, if you look at our politicians' behaviors, right, it's very problematic in very different ways. But the thing is, it's not that it was ever okay. It just, these were protests or complaints were never taken seriously. And so now we are using, you know, now the Me Too movement is really affirming women's experiences all along. Does it answer your question? No? Okay.
Next.
No? Yeah. With the Me Too movement, we're hearing a lot of cases where women are bringing up things that happened to them years and even decades ago. Mm-hmm. I'm a little interested in your explanation of why they wait so long. And second of all, should we have some kind of a ruling, whether it be in law or whether it be in culture, that not just with women and sexual crimes, but all crimes, that people should be required to report crimes in real time or shortly thereafter in order to protect other people in the community from being victimized by the same perpetrators?
Good question, and that raises, you know, why do people, I mean, that's a constant question, why do people wait so long, right? Because even now with the sort of Me Too movement, it is still very difficult for sexual assault survivors to come forward. Because most often time what they confront is disbelief, right? Is what I pointed out earlier, the victim blaming, right? People don't necessarily believe their claims. The first questions that people ask is, what were you wearing? Do you know each other, right? Now, and it's not just interpersonally, but every step of the way, they have to think about the media representation, right? They have to encounter law enforcement, criminal justice system. And I'll give you a good example of the most recent book by Know My Name, a memoir by Chanel Miller, who was a sexual assault survivor by a Stanford student, Brock Turner. Now, right from the start, the media represented him as a high achiever, the swimmer from Stanford University. So when we think about sexual assault survivor, that right from the start, they encounter where we consistently, right, represent the achievement and credentials and credibilities of perpetrators, particularly when they're middle upper class white people, right? And then we demonize women, we victimize. So sexual assault survivors, not just their original trauma, but they go through the secondary trauma when they experience people's disbelief, media representation, law enforcement, criminal justice system, and why it is difficult and sometimes it's not necessary to their interest to come forward. And so there's that. The other thing for me, is it necessary for them to come forward?
Protect others.
Sure, but then I also feel very ambivalent. It's their choice. because I also feel very ambivalent, the hostile environment that they might encounter once they come forward, right? And so for me is the trauma that they have to go through beyond being sexually assaulted, but the trauma, the secondary trauma that they might have to experience going through the scrutiny of everyone around them, questioning the validity of their claim. And that's secondary trauma, and it's re-traumatizing. And so for me, that's a major issue. And so for me, why is this important for us to think about? It's not just holding men accountable, but in terms of how all of us can buy into the cultural ideology in the system, right? And it has nothing to do with, and this is what I oftentimes say to people, it has nothing to do with whether you're a good person or not. Learning is easy. It's not about learning. Unlearning is difficult. Every step of the way is about unlearn the pattern, the thought pattern, the constructs and ideologies that have been in our head. It's not about learning new information, it's about unlearning. That's a key, and that's difficult to do.
Okay.
I have to ask about immigration, and should we be wary of bringing people in from countries where there's even more toxic masculinity? Should we be wary about bringing immigrants in from places that are like Islamic, misogynistic cultures?
Why is that particular toxic? When it is really toxic here, they just tar their toxic in a different way.
But should we be bringing in people who, if you disgrace the family, I have a right to honor kill you, or I have the right to bring you in the public square and stone you to death, or I have the right to force you into marriage?
Do you know how many women die in this country as a result of domestic violence? It's the same thing, except we don't name it as honor killing. But women die by intimate partners. Does that make sense? What I'm saying is this. There's a problem here in the United States. We consistently look at other culture as the other, as a savage. That we look at their practice as a culture, but we don't examine our own practice as cultural. Right? That we are assuming that women in this country are more progressive and liberated. Right?
Okay.
Right? That we are more civilized. But
we're not.
The number of women are killed in this country every day and sexually assaulted, except we don't label them as a cultural practice. But we see other cultural practice. And that has a lot to do with colonialism and imperialism. And I think that's the lens that we need to examine. This is not to say that violence against women doesn't exist. But it's also important to sort of think through how Orientalism, right? Let me use that term, Orientalism, that persistently that we frame the other as a savage or uncivilized in relation to how we see the West as the civilized. And so think about this. When you say honor killing, then I would ask, is nuclear a better way to kill people? Think about that. So when we sort of ask questions about other cultural practices, we need to look at the existing violence in this country.
But isn't it possible for us to import slavery or import practices such as female genital mutilation, or import practices such as child marriages, or
do you know that there are states that still are illegal to marry children here in the United States?
It is illegal to marry a child here.
It's legal.
It's legal.
There are some states that are still legal to marry. Yeah. There are certain states.
Yeah. I can't marry a 10-year-old boy in Illinois.
There's still states that allow, right? Think about certain groups, right? Certain, at least certain states, I need to go back to, but there are certain
Mormon.
States that allow
Georgia, probably.
Marry young children,
Mississippi.
Right, younger
Mississippi.
Ones.
Those are
so,
Utah. Yeah, Utah.
But here's also, I want to give you an example. I don't, you know, what you're talking about is cultural relativism here.
Okay.
I want you to really think about, so for example, intersex people. Our medical institutions have been consistently, let's say, operating on people with, let's say, sexual characteristics or, you know, may not seem as normal, right? We operate on these babies all the time, right? Without parental consent, informed consent, without children's consent, except we view it as medical practice, right? Now, this is really important for us to think about. It's medical institutions for decades, and now increasingly intersex people have been challenging this practice. People, you may say, well, this is not genital mutilation. Sure, we can say, sure, there's a degree of difference. But regardless, the medical institution operate on babies without their consent. But yet,
okay.
In this culture, we see as, oh, this is sanctioned by scientific community. This is sanctioned by medical institution. But yet, what's done in other cultures and other regions, that's savage. And we need to be also, I want to say this very, essentializing, right, is female genital mutilation is a practice everywhere in a particular culture or society? No. Just think about what, so it's a culture. When you think about what's Indian culture? What's Asian culture? I just want you to think, I'll give you British culture, African culture. You probably have some in your head, certain characteristics, right?
Republican culture.
Now, what's American culture? What's American culture?
Yeah, Donald Trump.
The nuclear family.
Okay, let me respond to that. Is slavery American culture?
Yep. Yes. I'd like to think now it isn't. I know it's very much in our history, but I today...
It is, still is.
Still is.
But we don't want to say it. Here's a problem. If it is so difficult to describe what's American culture, why do you think it should be easy to essentialize any culture? All cultures are dynamics, conflictual. They're always, just like in this room, they're status quo. There are also people who protest. When you think about American culture, right? And not just the dominant groups, Donald Trump, but they're also the 60s and 70s, a protest movement, social movement, right? It's the same in other societies and cultures. But yet, consistently, we use very essentialized characteristics to describe the non-Western culture. And that, for me, it's an option, it's a function of imperialism and colonialism and Orientals. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes. Question over here. You had your
hand. So is toxic masculinity just a different way of labeling gender bias? And if it's not, at what point does gender bias turn into toxic masculinity?
It's different. Gender bias is, I would say it's, you know, it's side by side. Essentially, we're talking about addressing the gender differentiation, right? Gender socialization. But toxic masculinity is about a particular way that boys and young men are raised in this country. So we're talking about more specifically about people who are assigned male in this country. Does that make sense? So it is an integral part of gender socialization, except it's not just about that we don't talk about in terms of ladies with women, but we specifically talking about how boys and young men are raised. But they are connected.
Next. Oh. Okay, go ahead.
I wonder if you would comment on the fact that there are many, many cultures that practice genital mutilation on boys, babies. And there are some that practice genital mutilation on girls. But there's no culture, let me think, what I'm trying to say is there are, if a culture practices genital mutilation on girls, they also do on boys. But there are many cultures that wouldn't dream of doing it on girls that still do it on every boy.
Mm-hmm. Can you say what they are?
I don't know all of them, but I think it's customary to circumcise baby boys.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not customary to circumcise. The circumcised baby mm-hmm. girls in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not Jewish,
mm-hmm.
but I had three boys,
mm-hmm.
and they were all circumcised.
Right.
And I know that in the culture I came from, which is the Mormon culture,
wow.
we never did circumcise girls.
The way that, you know, here's the thing is, it is very tricky when we think about cultural practices, and I never want to go to the point where that I can never critique a culture, right? That we do need to critique culture when it violates. But what we need to be very careful about is the lens through which we bring to see that particular culture. Now, and what has been really important is this, you know, different groups have been calling respect the human body, that children decide, right, as they grow older, what they want to do with their body, as opposed to being decided by the tradition, right, by the ritual, by what we think is appropriate. And that has been across the board. It's about how do we, you know, what's that tension between the so-called, you know, tradition of cultural practice versus the dignity of the human body. And that has been, you know, a movement in different communities and cultures and society, not just there, but here, just everywhere.
Charlie.
Okay. Hey, we had an election here a few years ago on the many accomplishments of the white European male. Virtually every subject. The arts and the sciences. Are these like extremely toxic men? Or what? How would explanation
speak for yourself, Charlie?
Conceivably after that.
In what sense? What's he toxic?
Well, they are outstanding in all subject matters. There's convincing data there.
Mm-hmm.
Music, the arts, mm-hmm. medical sciences, literature.
Mm-hmm.
They're inherently superior.
And they're superior because they're
superior
because of their innate ability, or they're superior because of the structure.
I don't know. That's what I'm asking you.
What if we didn't have slavery?
What if we didn't have wives? Helping them out, right?
What if women? Yeah. What if women are given the same opportunities right from the start? What if there's no structural inequity in terms of race, gender, class, or sexuality, right? So when we think about all these, that is, are people in higher position because of their innate intelligence and ability, or is it because of the structural inequity that enables them to be in a certain way? And this is what I want to make this very clear. This is not to say that people don't have ability or are not intelligent or don't work hard. But it is also to say that structural inequity, right, race, gender, class, sexuality, facilitate that smooth climbing of the ladder. And so you can see in academia, right, that we have women in administrative position, in teaching position, But then we have to ask, when did women start to have the right to vote? Right? When did women start entering universities? Right? When did women start working full-time? When they already work full-time at home? Right? When do women, and even now, women working outside still earn 78% of men earn. So is that about our natural ability, our difference in natural ability, or is it really a function of the structural inequity? Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right.
Our president is famous for being a women lover. He was taped speaking to somebody in a van, something about grabbing women, and he said he denied it. And the media said, fine, okay, you denied it, it didn't happen. I mean, when the president can say that, what is going on? What does it say about a country?
Yeah, I agree.
What
now,
about Clinton?
I want you to look at
Clinton
the difference.
Too.
The great question after this, the other gentleman.
Thank you.
I want you to look at this presidency and the president, Barack Obama.
Yeah.
Right?
Nice guy.
Can you imagine Obama was accused of groping just one woman?
As a black man, he would not have
had affairs, gave money to workers.
But he was gay.
They say he's gay. She's
right?
A man.
He's gay.
Now,
that was an issue.
That's
every step of the way, you look at the differences in these two presidents. Don't you wonder why that he still continued to stay on as the presidency? And how do you even explain that? Is it simply about him being a man? Or is it the fact that he's a white man? Right? So gender is never detached from race. Every step of the way that he has been accused by so many women, right? This level of incompetence, the hateful rhetoric against immigrants, yet and Obama never once had any sort of major scandal. And you have to wonder, right? And Michelle Obama, highly accomplished, highly educated. So you have to wonder what comes to play? Race. Right? And you have to wonder why consistently people want to vote for him against their own interest. Right? Yeah.
Next. Ellen.
Yeah, I love your talk, and for me these issues are much clearer as I'm older and have tried to, you know, like I've experienced, tried to run for office and realized how difficult, you know, when you try to push yourself there.
Yeah.
And also trying to change a system, you know, help people who are wrongfully convicted. But I've read that 1/3 of women in the military are raped and nothing happens, you know, and I would suspect there's a lot of that with among the police too.
Yeah.
So when you see these institutional differences, you know, I'm a teacher, a social worker, can't get a job, you know, but the police unions and there these institutional inequities. I don't know what we can do to change it, but
it's really hard, isn't it? It's and there's you brought a really important point, and I focus on culture in this aspect. The structural, right, institutional is another sort of major block. And it's very difficult to really change. But then you can't really, you don't want to lose hope, right? You know, I quit my job at DePaul. I mean, and there's a reason why. At some point, I didn't realize, you know, didn't feel that I could really make changes. But then after I left and I realized, we need to have people inside the institution. We need to have people outside the institution using different strategies for change, right? Mm-hmm. But institutions are difficult to transform, particularly if you're done. It's not just reform, but transform is very difficult. Then, and it takes decades and centuries. But the thing is, I always feel, for me, is I don't want to lose hope, right? And I hope the younger generation, I really have to say, younger generations are very different generations where, you know, they really mobilize their thinking in structural terms. And so, you know, I have hope, right? But, I have to say, sometimes I feel pessimistic, sometimes I'm optimistic. It just depending on the, you know, the time. But I totally understand if you're talking about political system, how difficult it is for women to run offices.
Do you see this in Bernie versus Biden? I mean, it seems to me Bernie is, it probably is anti-Semitism or something. There's a favorability toward Biden that, I mean, the media doesn't cover much different at all, but there's differences, right?
If you ask for, you know, my personal is, why would I, so for me, I'm for Bernie, right? And so I always have question about why, and I can understand. I can certainly understand why some voters might feel safer, right? But we're at a point where we need to have major transformation. Mm-hmm. We cannot be business as usual.
Okay. We just got one question. All right.
Jonathan.
Who hasn't had one yet? Jonathan?
Ellen?
Okay. Well, I was wondering if you knew about Tony Porter, and I think he has a nonprofit or something called A Call to Men, and I was wondering if you knew about that. And then the second thing is, it seems like the Me Too movement focuses a lot on sexual assault, and I don't hear much talk about domestic violence. I know there is some of that, but it just seems like there's as much or more stigma and victim blaming, maybe more victim blaming with domestic violence. And I know that women do domestic violence as well, engage in domestic violence as well, but I'm just wondering why there isn't a bigger focus, because it's such a massive problem, domestic violence.
So now there are a lot of different groups really focus on the issue of toxic masculinity. Mm-hmm. You're in Chicago, Illinois, and other places where a lot of progressive men's groups, and this has become, you know, it has started decades ago where people seriously talking about toxic masculinity. So they're, so I'm just one of the, you know, I'm doing this on my own facilitated workshops, but there has been a lot of groups that are going on, really calling people in general, examine how this culture can affect all of us. The other thing, I tend to use a gender-based violence, right? Me too. And of course, because it has sort of geared towards sexual assault because of how it started. But I tend to use gender-based violence as an umbrella term to include sexual assault, intimate partner violence, and when I want to talk about Me Too in a more broader term, I don't simply focus on sexual assault. I tend to think in terms of gender-based violence in general because they are all connected. Even though, yes, Me Too tends to focus on sexual assault about a lot more. And that's why I prefer simply just use gender-based violence more generally for us to think about not just focus on women, but examine the power inequity between groups. That's what gender is about, right? And so I use the term very differently.
Oh, no.
Okay.
So there's a lot of power and equity in domestic violence situations.
Absolutely.
And yet, instead of examining that, people just blame the women for not leaving.
There's that, too. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We see victim blaming. You know, and if you kind of pay attention to what I did is very early on, that's kind of how we cultivate very different ways to think about our gender, right?
It's about time to go to rebuttals.
Yeah, we,
Who wants to get a rebuttal tonight?
All right, let's thank our speaker. You'll get the last word. You'll get the last word. We're now going into rebuttals. All right, Andy.
Let's have a show of hands here. Who wants to give a rebuttal or add something? Please keep your hands up until I get a count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Andy,
I got nine. Okay.
About 3 minutes, you think?
Yeah, we have time for the usual 3 minutes, and make it as brief as you can.
All right.
Who's first?
I'll go first.
All right, go ahead.
Women on campus. There's a rumor about that.
Thank you. That was a wonderful talk, and I really am interested in going to your University of Illinois clinic. I've seen it online, the women's leadership clinic there, and I haven't been there, so it sounds like a huge opportunity to raise consciousness. It's really interesting. I think I didn't understand a lot. I didn't understand about human rights or women's lib until I actually experienced that I don't really have rights. You know, you kind of have to bump into it. And but I was thinking about crying. Remembering your first cry. My brother, when I was like 3, the first memory is that they say your first memory kind of shows your personality, and they said you never cried, and for 3 years you didn't cry, and but now you're a crybaby, and your grandmother doesn't love you, doesn't want to see you anymore because they say you're a crybaby, and I remember sitting there and thinking, well, what do I do now? I'm all alone. I'll just hammer, you know, and take care of myself, and it's interesting how. Still, it's so hard to think that I can tell on people. I can cry too, like your grandmother, and say, you know, they're bullying me. And actually, my big brother and my big sister were bullying all the time. And I think it's interesting. I was going to ask about women, women bullies. You know, how we, you know, there's a lot of that, and it. It's when you least expect it, you know, the places that are where you're vulnerable, that is difficult. But you know, I think it's interesting what Dan said. I learned to cry a lot in AA, my first time in AA, and I just couldn't stop because and I don't know. It's like there was compassion in the culture, in the room, you know, and it felt like the sins are just falling off, you know, like the tears can be so healing, really, you know, and so there probably could be a lot done in the mental health space, you know, just dealing with crying. And also, I saw a great thing, Bell Hooks there's a documentary of her. They have men who have been put away in prison for life, for murdering people, and so they read the book, and the men talk about, you know, what good does this patriarchy do for me? And I thought it was interesting. One guy said, you know, they make it on the list, and you really kind of think, you know, it's not, there's nothing good about, you know, me being macho and I end up killing somebody, my life is over. But the guy, I remember this Mexican guy, they talk about machismo, and he said, Well, I can accept this, but I still want my son to be tough. You know, and the degree to which, you know, our parents acculturate us, and it's so limiting, and it is, you know, it's a great work you're doing. So, thank you.
All right.
This is where the vertically gifted person has to readjust the microphone.
Okay, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Okay. This is a rebuttal period, and I definitely want to make a rebuttal. But not to the speaker. I really enjoyed the talk, and I thought it was appropriate and a great topic. Before the speaker got up, there was someone else that brought up a different topic that I wanted to make a quick comment on. They mentioned a book on the 9/11 conspiracy, and me being, I like to think of myself as an open-minded person. I went back, took a little break, and went back, and I opened the book, and I opened it to a page, and it's basically separated into a bunch of points. And there seem to be long points and just one page points. And one page point I first talked to said that if you think about it, there's no building before 9/11 or since 9/11 that was brought down by a fire. No steel structure buildings. Now, this is according to the book. I don't know if it's true or not. But it says there's not one example of a steel structure building that was brought down by fire before 9/11 or since 9/11. I'm not sure what that really proves. I'm not sure it actually proves her point. Maybe you could argue that it makes things suspicious. The problem that the author has is that they leave out a very minor detail. And that is there's a big jumbo jet that flew into the structure. So she neglects in this page, this from a book of proofs, she neglects to mention that before 9/11 and since 9/11, there's not one example of a jumbo jet flying into a skyscraper. Oh, and by the way, this might be unimportant, that jumbo jet was carrying 80,000 pounds of kerosene. That's all I'm going to say about that. There was a brief mention about the book, and that's my brief rebuttal. So thanks to the speaker.
Okay. All right, next, please. All right.
Well, I didn't get a chance to get my notes straight, but
why don't you let her go and get your notes straight?
Okay.
Pull the mic down a little bit so we can see your face. Yeah. Go ahead.
One day I learned how to make drapes for a bedroom. And one of my little boys needed drapes for his bedroom. So I went to the shop where my teacher worked, because it was Calico Corners, and it was up in Highland Park, I think, or Northbrook or something. And we went through the place, and he picked out the fabric that he wanted for his drapes. It was a moire pattern, of the pale blue moire pattern. So I took this up to my teacher. She was waiting on me, and she was the one who taught me how to do this. And my son was standing right by me. He was about 11, maybe 10. And she looked at that fabric, and I kid you not, I'm not exaggerating, she said, "For a boy's room?" And my son was standing right there. He never was able to choose anything else. He no longer accepted the pale blue moire pattern. We went through the store again. There was nothing else that he wanted. And as a result, I don't even remember what happened after that.
I can go real quick, Andy.
Okay, well, Jim will go. Keep studying.
What kind of pattern?
No, you have to.
Moire?
Blue?
First of all, I want to thank our speaker again for an enlivening talk.
Yeah.
Although I don't agree with some of the points she has said about, you know, gendered biases and differences, she does bring up a good point, though, that our society, I think, needs to bring what I call civility back. Meaning that I think underlying the basic message is the fact that we need to get out of our own individualistic American-like culture and get a little bit more of the, needless to say, coming out of the collectivist ideas back into society. Meaning that it's good that we look after our neighbor. It's good that we respect each other's property, bodies, and boundaries. And what is it they say? High fences make good neighbors. You know, the one thing that I've been learning since I've gotten a little older is that the internet's been a great thing for communications, but it's also tended to done a lot of isolation for a lot of people. And you know, I could clearly exhibit this yesterday when I went to a small supermarket after work. It was a place in Schiller Park. I actually asked the person behind me, "What's so interesting on the phone?" "Oh, I'm just texting my daughter." "Oh, what's happening?" And she says, "Well," she told me a little bit of this hard luck story about, you know, how her daughter was stuck in California and how she was having a little trouble getting along. And then she, all of a sudden, puts her phone away and starts talking to me a little bit and wound up helping her take her groceries to the car and everything, you know, and it was my good deed for the day. But it was just amazing how much she felt that she had to stare at the screen of that phone rather than talk to the person next to her in line. And I think she was kind of grateful that she had a chance to vent a little bit with some of the frustrations that she had had. And I was grateful to listen. But I think in a lot of ways, I wouldn't have done that 10 years ago. Probably because I would have been scared to even enter into a conversation with a person of the opposite sex, because at that time, you know, I've seen a lot of aggressive females who tend to manipulate. And let's face it, if you're a man and you run a business and you're white and you want to, and you, even though you're progressive, you're going to think twice about promoting that woman to a management position, especially if she's going to have a one-on-one meetings with you. You know, on the one hand, you want to see equality for women, but on the other, are they going to stick around for a few years with your all the attention you're getting? And second, what's people going to say in the office if you take her out to lunch? What's people going to say if you do it because of the couples type thing? Oh, she's just manipulating, you know, because of what you basically said. And I know a lot of men who, because of the Me Too movement, have closed up quite a bit more. They're not willing to, you know, promote the women like they used to because of the fear that they might be accused of sexual harassment, even though there's nothing with it. They might be afraid of having a staff meeting one-on-one with somebody because they might be accused of by somebody else of something else.
Then use matchmaker.
And the other thing that I want to bring up is, yeah, I do agree there's a lot of bias and a lot of gender differentiations and roles, but one of the things I am seeing is that people are just a little bit too insensitive. They can't let things roll off their sleeves like they used to. And I'm not saying to bottle up your emotions. I'm talking about healthy, dynamic relationships.
Right.
And I've just seen a lot more people over the last maybe 10 or 15 years become a lot more self-centered rather than community-centric.
Right.
And if I was to say anything tonight about the college and everything else, yeah, we fight a lot, we have a lot of commotion, but you know, afterwards we're all friends and we all go home and
we're all good friends.
Well, yeah, maybe not you, Charlie. But we're a little bit more community centric around here by having this forum. And if I was to say anything from all of us, let's get a little bit more, as Charlie would say, collectivized rather than individualistic, or perhaps neighbor centric.
They're imbalanced.
Well, about 50% of students admit to binge drinking, including men and women, on the campus, and this makes them liable to there might be a sexual encounter. Feminist women should take precautions and be aware of their surroundings and deal with this. But I was going to say the major welfare programs of the late 60s required recipients to be unmarried to qualify for benefits. This was followed by the legalization of abortion in 1973, which had a devastating effect on the black family and the black male. It upset their whole family structure. In the 50s, a black family was strong. And then they passed this, and a social psychologist stated that the middle class women and upper class women who attend expensive universities are the greatest malcontents in American life. A lot of ways they're better off than men. They got a better income, better education, and a lot of the women are pampered a lot of them are angry and malcontent. Now, the other thing I was going to say is two generations of Americans have told only their sons, not their daughters, that they had to fight their nature. This is what the feminists are pushing. They're feminizing our society and feminizing our boys, who turn out to be funny adults.
Funny,
yes. The males are required to suppress their nature, and the feminists really believe that females are superior, and that's what they're pushing.
Yeah. I'm with him. You got that.
The nice thing about the college is you'll get all points of view up here from time to time. And we shouldn't be so cocky and always think our point of view is right. I guess the main thing I would like to bring out is what I brought out in my question. I think it is important to the Me Too movement is great. We've got a lot of talk that is coming out that was suppressed by people. People are talking about things that they weren't talking about before. They're willing to acknowledge. But I think it's important that in all types of crimes, but especially in these kinds of intergender crimes should be reported promptly. Because if not, the perpetrator will feel free to go on and do it to somebody else, or maybe even the same person again. Whereas if they're stopped, if it's nipped in the bud, I think that helps everybody. Now, the cases I think about particularly, actually would be Dennis Hastert, our former Speaker of the House, who was abusing all these boys.
Yeah.
And nobody said anything until way toward the end. And that could have been probably, the whole chain could have been stopped. And the whole priest scandal had more to do with the fact that nobody was saying anything. And if somebody had, a lot of those cases would not have occurred. And then, of course, if we look at the Michigan State, the Dr. Nasser, the Olympic guy, I was really, when I hear about that, I get angry at the girls. I say, why aren't these girls saying anything? Why didn't they say anything? They could have prevented this. Well, it turns out they were saying it. A lot of them were talking to people, to other adults involved, including even their parents, and nobody was taking it seriously. Now, finally, when things broke, then a lot of people did, or a few people, did get fired. I think even the president of the university may have resigned.
Yeah.
I think there's an attitude there, they were going to give Nasser 500 years. I guess they figure if they give this guy 500 years, then we can forgive all the other adults that were involved that didn't do anything but didn't stop it as well. So I think this is a way we need to deal with the problem as well. Harvey Weinstein, now here's a guy who, we don't want to be too terribly sympathetic with, but I think this 23-year sentence, at least for these two crimes, was a little excessive. I think the attitude is, well, we're going to get him now for all the other things he did, which maybe he did. I don't think he was a wonderful human being to work with, but he was a little overdone there. And one last thing. Somebody here talked about Biden versus Trump and their proclivities, okay? I don't think that there's any reasonable equivalence there. We've got Biden, who's the hair sniffer, and then we've got Trump, who's the pussy grabber. And the hair sniffer gave at least some kind of an apology, whereas the pussy grabber said, this is what we do, this is what we can do, we can get away with it. Thank you.
Biden touches too, he touches.
Yeah, I don't know how much I talked about when I gave the speech on UPS. I might have mentioned a little bit how the Me Too movement hit UPS. Because in business, they have this culture, right, of people using their position of power. Mostly white males use their position of power to, and what they do is promote younger female supervisors. And most of the blame would have to go to the people in positions of power. But they're also complicit in the whole thing as well. And it hit UPS, and it was a big scandal, and a UPS manager may have been fired or displaced and moved around, because of it, because a lower level female supervisor was having a relationship with two management personnel at UPS. Now, in particular, at the Harvey UPS facility, and when all this going on, race and gender, it also does come into play, because we had a supervisor, a shift manager, Ken Wagner. You call him Wagner because he looked like Colonel Klink, from Hogan's Heroes. All he needed is that monocle, and he ran UPS, like Willie Lynch. If anybody's familiar with Willie Lynch and slavery, what he would do. He would have relationships with younger black female supervisors, employees, and then they would move them up to supervisory positions, and then it would be like a symbiotic relationship, because now they got something on him to use against him if anything ever comes up, so then they can be incompetent, and then also now they're resentful and angry, and they harass the people, the workers under them, which are mostly male workers. The male and female workers at UPS, but they tend to be more male, and they'll be sexually harassed by these female supervisors who are in positions. Cause all this is related to power, when people are in positions of power. So as more and more women become in positions of power in business, you might see a trend for them doing the same toxic behavior.
Yeah.
Because everything in this world is a matter of power.
Management.
You know? So, and right now, it's usually, you know, white males are in positions of power, so you see this behavior from them. But, I mean, we need to get rid of capitalism, and we need to get rid of hierarchy in both of those things. Oh, yeah. So we don't have these relations of power that are abused.
I don't know.
So, everything's a matter of power.
Well, it didn't come tonight. I kept on
I'm against the Soviet Union.
Yeah. I kept on expecting to see an email or something that the gathering was canceled, since practically everything is being canceled now. Not much has been discussed about this Canora virus going around. I don't have it. I just wore these gloves as a precaution. I think we're all going to probably be taking more precautions. I'm glad that people were brave enough to come out and that this event has not been canceled, and I hope it doesn't meet the fate of the NCAA tournament. But it'll save me some time that I won't have to watch any games for the next 3 weeks. That's one good thing, I guess. But no, it's a terrible thing. Anyway, I have always been I've always called myself a feminist.
Right.
I've always been for equal rights
right.
for women. I got that as being just with the left kind of leaning that I've always had going back to childhood, really. And at times I've been even farther left than I am now. It was kind of the accepted wisdom on the left back when I was in college. But, you know, being a feminist didn't do me any good getting dates or anything. There's no advantage that way. You can't blame me for that. All right, I didn't really have a lot of stuff prepared to say, but I wore blue gloves to say vote blue no matter who. And don't let this epidemic get so bad. And some people suspect that Trump wanted it to get bad. That's why, partly why he put off doing anything about it for 3 to 4 weeks. And there were test kits available if he'd used ones available through the WHO organization with the UN. Or got them from South Korea. They were available before he put up this scheme, which a lot of people suspect he has some kind of an in with these companies that he put up. DGX is the symbol on the stock market for one of them, and the other one is called LabCorp. LH is the symbol. And at any rate, don't let Trump get away with extending this epidemic to the time of the election so he can use it as an excuse for postponing the election. All right?
Sure.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. Jonathan.
Thank you to our speaker. This is one of the best talks we've ever had at college in a long time. And
mine was good.
I continue to urge everyone to invite
ours
more people
better,
to
Charlie.
College, especially invite people who are feminists. And that's not a bad word, just like being a liberal isn't a bad word. It's election week, so read this book if you've got it. It's called Listen Liberal by Thomas Frank, What Happened to the Party of the People. I think it's really helpful election time, especially. And there's an article on Truthdig where Jeremy Scahill writes an article called, he makes the definitive case against Joe. We need to talk about Joe. It's a great article, Truthdig. So, 3 minutes, my goodness. All right. In a world where civics works for all of us, pro-corporate policy-minded politicians would have a very difficult time receiving enough of our votes, support, volunteering, and donations to run for local public office. have an extraordinarily difficult time to run for state public office, have a profoundly indescribable difficult time to run for national public office, and a near impossible time to run for head of state or a chance of being even remotely considered for a cabinet position. And while we're on that subject, why aren't all cabinet member candidates on our ballots so we the people decide who are in those positions? Why does that get, you know, just done by the DNC? I don't understand that.
Mm-hmm.
In a world where civics works for all of us, pro-corporate policy-minded politicians would not routinely avoid public scrutiny and media skepticism slash thorough analysis in regards to their character, which we spoke a lot about tonight, their record, which we spoke a lot about tonight, their judgment, which we spoke a lot about tonight, their mental state of mind, which we spoke a lot about tonight, and their accomplishments and the path they chose to follow in their careers to gain access, status, wealth, and influence in order to be viewed as legitimate candidates. Third-way Democrats are the prime reason why our legislature is so eager to go further and further to the extreme right, far away from where our values, our goals, and our interests are clearly rooted. This, if you can't beat them, then join them addiction is what fuels the fire of self-defeat. On virtually every topic before the decisions that damage your and my life, for better or for worse, are made by a small cartel of members of the ruling elite. With friendly Democrats like Joe Biden, who needs enemy Republicans like Donald Trump, Mike Pence, Stephen Miller, Jeff Sessions, John Bolton, Steve Bannon, Mike Pompeo, Steve Mnuchin, Sebastian Gorka, Rex Tillerson, Betsy DeVos, Ben Carson, etc.
That's why we need a chance
and the rest of the Swamp Creatures crew who are currently masquerading as our last chance to finally make the United
Vote
States
libertarian.
A place where we live with a high quality of life like people do every day all over the industrialized world.
Get rid of the duopoly.
Just
Vote
as
libertarian.
The band The Who say in their song, Don't Get Fooled Again, don't surrender our liberties, our lives, and the planet to these serial con artists. Thank you to our speaker for a great talk.
All right, Jonathan.
All right, Jonathan.
For president.
Okay, hi. My name is Ellen, and I just wanted to say a few words. I recommend everybody Google Tony Porter, A Call to Men. It's an excellent YouTube video. And he has an organization where he's trying to get men to reach out to help stop gender-based violence. I do find, I do have some issues with the Me Too movement. I wish that there was more focus on domestic violence, which is like, I think every bit as prevalent, probably as sexual assault or more so, probably more prevalent. And I find it very disturbing that there's incredible amount of victim blaming when it comes to domestic violence, on both men and women's part. And I think I think our society has a real problem. You know, it is a good idea to to condemn female genital mutilation and the horrible things that go on in other cultures. But yeah, it is true. There are, you know, very serious problems with our culture. I meet very few people who really focus, who are introspective and who focus on ethics. I mean, I'm going to be really honest. There's a lot of people who do not fall in that camp. And we need a lot more of that. I don't know, I'm not really into social media. I don't know that that's such a good thing for those issues. When I was growing up, I was bullied a lot by the boys. And I don't know, now as an adult, I don't really notice much difference necessarily between, you know, the bad behavior. There's so many women and men who behave badly. But when I was a kid growing up, I was always bullied by boys. I don't know what it is, whether it was just like kind of this culture that they could just get away with whatever they wanted and act out their aggression. I know that there is more of a focus on bullying nowadays. I don't know how great of an emphasis that, you know, how much is really going on, but hopefully there is. And then, you know, I want to mention that, you know, you were talking about how women are socialized and how men are socialized, and yeah, I mean, there's that big sexual double standard that's very significant and can cause a lot of problems for a lot of women. Now, I grew up with all sisters, but for some reason, I was socialized to not show any weakness. And for some reason, when I was younger, I never asked for help with anything. And so I can say those things are very bad for human psychology to grow up with that kind of
I'm doing the best I can.
All right, first of all, I'd like to thank the speaker for a very interesting talk. With regard to the person who said that women are overeducated and pampered, well, all I have to say to that is women basically seem to be complaining about the same things that everybody else does, demands that they be treated equally as equal citizens. Well, why is that a problem? I don't have a problem with it. Why should anyone else?
All right.
And they are complaining about the same general problems for the most part that everyone else is complaining about, as well they should. With regard to those people who are saying, well, we should all vote for Senator Sanders, that's a load of radical hooey. I'm voting for Joseph Biden next Tuesday because that's he is our last best hope for getting that son of a bitch out of the White House and giving Washington a good thorough house cleaning that it's going to need after he leaves office. And that's what I have to say. Thank you.
All right. Charlie!
All right, let's thank our speaker for a very, very nice talk, and we look forward to seeing you again. You're on the schedule, I believe, for another day coming up pretty soon. Okay, I got three issues very quickly. We're a little bit running out of time here. You called it toxic. Why isn't there a program on toxic femininity? Why isn't there a program on genderinity and genders? Why is it lopsided, your subject matter here? How about a little neutrality? And so forth, at least from a sociological or anthropological perspective. But anyhow, it's very good. The second thing I'm going to talk about is, you kind of missed the point. The white European male, here, give you the example, encountered the Native Americans, who has cultures I love and studied for decades, yet there was a disparity between the Native Americans, the Indians, have been here for 10,000 years, and yet those two cultures, when they came together, the disparity was just amazing. The levels at which they were dealing with one another. They had nothing in common, as a matter of fact. This has been addressed in certain books, as to one in particular comes to mind, Gun, Germs, and Steel. But nevertheless, the white European male has distinguished himself among other cultures. Other cultures, other continents. And it was not due to the factors that you listed. But anyhow, it's another topic worth pursuing. The last of all, the thing is, the people are, you hit on it, somebody said, in men and women, boys and girls are socialized. Socialized for what purpose? To undertake positions within the nuclear family. And I don't think I've heard you mention that during the evening. That's, I think, more the common denominator of the fundamental unit, you know. And I don't want to sound like a Republican or Ronald Reagan, but the nuclear family is a central feature of American society. Thank you.
And we won't see it torn asunder.
Wow. I sounded like Charlie and Charlie.
Andy,
sounded like
you're
me.
Speaking, right?
Save the family.
I just may like to make a quick observation. Is the speaker working back there, or can you hear me?
Yeah, you're fine.
Not too good. Right.
It's working. Right?
There are examples. I think what everybody is missing, or not, they don't stress it in America, is this, the toxic masculinity with relation to women and kids. It stems from the huge gap of inequality. Societies that are more equal don't have as much toxic masculinity, where you have 50%, like the Scandinavian countries, in Germany, some of the others, they have, half the parliament is made up of women, or maybe more. And a fictional society in the future that is very attainable, one of the most popular programs on television was Star Trek The Next Generation, where they portrayed all people of all genders were free after they were born to just grow up and be be the best they could be without being harassed or attacked by anybody else. People had, it's a question of equality, economic equality. So, as we talk about the difference between billionaires owning half the planet, this is where one of the reasons where it stems from, I think. Economic inequality, for sure. So, our speaker will get the last word. Come on up and summarize in a few minutes.
I can't respond to you at every point, but there are a few points I want to respond.
Let's have order.
So, if you bring up, do you believe in reverse racism? Right? If you have a question if reverse racism exists, right? Reverse racism is not equivalent to racism. Then there's a problem when you bring toxic femininity versus toxic masculinity. Mm. Right? These are not equivalent. We're talking about power, right? Who is in power? We're talking about structural inequity. The other thing, unfortunately, it doesn't mean to target one person. If you bring up the concept of nuclear family exists, didn't start to emerge until the 18th and 19th century with the industrialization process, right? It's not a historically consistent family form. It is a form that emerged within a particular historical context with the development of industries. And so to bring that as the representative of the American family unit, I think that's ahistorical, but also miss sight of the fact that there are different cultures and communities that nuclear family may not be the only family unit that we're talking about. So I think we need to be very careful. But other than that, I just want to say thank you very much for being here. I know this is an uncertain time, so I really want to say thank you for being here. This is really important. We are at a point in time where the society is so divided that we cannot have productive and respective and constructive dialogue without attacking and assaulting one another. So I really want to commend this particular format, where people can still have respectful conversation. And so I want to congratulate you maintaining this. And the final point, as an educator, my goal is not to change people's minds. My goal is simply to plant the seed.
Educate.
Thank you.
All right. Hold this out, Amy.
Very good.
Come back.
March 14th.
We will
see you next week.
We're out.
Thank you.
Okay, we got you.